Good afternoon, everyone.
How are you?
How's everybody doing? Welcome to the Ralph J. Bunn Center for African American Studies. I'm Darnell Hunt, director of the center, and it's my pleasure today to introduce to you Tsekani Browne, who will be our Circle of Thought lecturer for today. Tsekani Browne completed his BA in African American Studies at UCLA in 1995. He completed his MA in African American Studies in 1998, writing an MA thesis entitled "The Widest Possible Application of Democratic Principles, Gender and Nation in W.E.B. Du Bois Political Thought, 1907 to 1920. He is currently a doctoral candidate in American History at UCLA, preparing a dissertation entitled "Anya Julia Cooper and Black Women's Intellectual Tradition, Race, Gender, and Nation in the Imperial Age, 1892 to 1925. Mr. Browne has presented before the American Historical Association, the National Association of African American Studies, National Black Graduate Student Association, and in addition, he has previously made presentations in Paris, France, Memphis, Tennessee, and here at UCLA. Tsekani is currently an Institute of American Culture's pre-doctoral fellow through the Center for African American Studies, that is the Ralph J. Bunn Center for African American Studies, and the Graduate Division. He has been recipient of the Research Mentorship Award, Graduate Opportunity Fellowship, GAP Award, Institute of American Cultures Research Grant at UCLA, and he has been a summer fellow at the School of Criticism and Theory at Cornell University. He was recently awarded a dissertation fellowship by the Black Studies Department at the University of California, Santa Barbara for the 2003-04 academic year. Tsekani Browne.
Good afternoon. Trying to circulate a couple of things for you. One is an outline of the presentation today so you sort of know where I'm at as far as time and everything. We should have a few minutes to be on for questions and answers. Second is a list of key quotations from management and people referred to, which I'll refer to in the presentation today. And the last two are just more sort of contextual information for you. And the last sheet is a timeline of Anna Julia Cooper's life and sort of major events in her life, which I'll discuss. I'm going to start the presentation by talking about the sort of background of the study, how I sort of arrived at this study, because it's hard to understand my particular perspective. But before I do that, I actually want to make some quick acknowledgments. I know it's impossible to thank everyone that's helped me out with this project over the years. I've been at UCLA since 1991 now, so I'm going to be able to begin to try to do that. But there are some people I need to thank, first of all. One is the Institute of American Cultures Fellowship and Research Grant Program through the Bunn Center for African American Studies. They're supporting me, especially this year, but they've supported me all along in my research efforts. I want to thank them. The faculty and staff of the Bunn Center, including Dr. Donald Hunt, Jan Freeman, Alex Tucker, Veronica Benson, and especially Lee Wright, have been forced to live with this project. More about Anna Julia Cooper than you probably ever wanted to know. I thank my advisor, Ben Stevenson, and my committee members, who include Robert Hill, Ellen Du Bois in the history department here, Tyler Stovall in the history department at UC Berkeley, and Richard Yarbrough in the English department in the Center for African American Studies, Bunn Center for African American Studies. Also many members of my sort of intellectual community that helped me develop this project over the years, including some of whom are here today. Jessica Millwood, for example, has finished her dissertation here at UCLA. Damian Thomas, who's not here, Jacoby Williams, Rob Baker, Jacoby's here, and Lee Ryder as well, has helped with this preparation of this particular presentation and others. So I just want to start there with the thank yous, and I apologize for everyone who I've forgotten. You're not really forgotten, just forgot to mention it today. Okay, let's sort of overview of the origins of this project. As Dr. Hunt mentioned, this project was really born out of my MA thesis on W.B. Du Bois. I wrote a thesis that dealt with Du Bois and the way he discussed issues of gender and nation, especially ideas of womanhood and nationhood. In the period between 1907 and 1920. I found it interesting that he discussed womanhood and nationhood in sort of similar terms as sort of political projects. It really compared ideas of nationalism and feminism in a particular way. even though he had particular difficulties with certain women in leadership positions. I think it's interesting that he was able to do that on this sort of intellectual level. Excuse me. But as I was doing this project, there was a certain person that kept sort of injecting herself into the discussion. This was Anna Julia Cooper. She continuously emerged as a sort of sometimes an unacknowledged member of the voiced intellectual community. And there are certain parallels between them that are interesting to consider. Both of them had the Reverend Alexander Crummell as a major mentor in their lives, for example. Both of them participated in the Pan-African Congress in 1900 together. Both of them eventually became members of the NAACP. And they had a long-term correspondence and letter-writing sort of campaign between them. Even though Du Bois would sometimes do things like quote Anna Julia Cooper without giving her credit for the quotations. It's also interesting that there are many parallels in their work, especially between The Voice of the South, which is Cooper's major work, which I'll discuss today, and things like Souls of Black Folk for Du Bois that appears 10 years after The Voice of the South. There's some interesting parallels between their work there that I'd like to begin to think about. Also, their dissertation project. Both of them did dissertations on the slave trade and the abolition of the slave trade, which I think is an interesting sort of parallel or similarity between them. Again, I've been working on this project now for a number of years, and even though I'm still sort of in the preliminary research stages, I still have much more research to do. The project has changed a lot over time. It initially began as a sort of continuation of my MA thesis, thinking primarily about intersections of gender and nations in the rhetoric and intellectual discourse of Anna Julia Cooper, and especially Voice from the South, her major work. But looking at her work, it really got me more interested in thinking about her life in relation to the work. So what I've begun to do is move much more towards an intellectual biography of Anna Julia Cooper, and thinking about how the life and the work go together in particular ways. But there are several problems with this approach. First of all, as you can see from the timeline, Anna Julia Cooper lived a long time and did a lot of stuff. She lived 105 years. And so, not wanting to write a sort of multi-volume dissertation, I decided that I need to find other ways to sort of treat the critical moments of her life. There's several critical moments that I'll refer to some of them today. Her early life in slavery and her early education in North Carolina, her move to Ohio and education in Oberlin and teaching career with Wilberforce. Her move to Washington, D.C. is a sort of major turning point in her life in 1887, which I'll come to. But also her sort of introduction to the black elite community, black intellectual elite community in D.C., and women's community in Washington, D.C. Also, Voice from the South appears when she's living in D.C., which is her major home for the remainder of her life, for the most part. Issues of mobility are important to Anna Julia Cooper. I'm going to get to some of these today. She moves around a lot. She has this sort of ability to move from Missouri to New York to Paris to the Midwest in certain cases was in response to certain controversial periods of her life. She gets involved in something called the M Street controversy, which I'll mention in the presentation in a moment. So along with being interested in Anna Julia Cooper as a particular individual, I'm sort of interested in larger black intellectual communities, especially communities of black women. But I still have this sort of general interest in black nationalism and how it sort of affects or intersects with the work of black intellectuals, especially women figures who are not necessarily considered in stories of black nationalism traditionally. But there's been a reversal of priority on this. Instead of black nationalism being the sort of the major goal, the goal is really on Anna Julia Cooper's life and work and how it's influenced by black nationalism. I'm going to look at the way that black nationalism is gendered, the way that it's very often geographically based, and the way that it can be both radical and conservative at the same time. I think that's an interesting fact. We tend to think about black nationalism as either very radical or very conservative, but I think it can be both. It has been both. And I'm interested in two notions of community for Anna Julia Cooper. One, her sort of her liberal community, you know, who she lived with, who her friends were, this type of stuff. But also a sort of larger intellectual community, people that she was influenced by that didn't necessarily live with her in D.C., but she was influenced by their work and influenced others as well. Some of the sort of major themes that emerge from work on her are things like the way that she was influenced by popular movements and intellectual discourses at the time, things like feminism, nationalism, progressivism as important sort of themes. These ideas affect not only her ideas, but her sort of activism, how she saw herself as an activist and an intellectual. Some of the major themes that emerged from Voice from the South, which I'll get into, are things like notions of womanhood, particular constructions of black womanhood that I think are interesting to consider. We can talk more about this in the question and answer period. Also, she was very concerned with protection of black women's sexuality, especially young black women, education, the South as an idea, and Western culture, and ideas of dependence that I'll use, especially when I talk about the dissertation project, to provide a sort of context, I think, to her larger career and Voice from the South as well. One of the things also was circling around were some photos of Anna Julie Cooper. The reason why I wanted to do that is because, one, in talking about her being sort of abstract, she sort of begins to disappear as a person. She did a lot of amazing things. So I think it's good to be able to keep in mind that she was a real person, a black woman, you know, active at the turn of the century. But also the sort of way she represents herself, the way she presented herself was very significant. She was very influenced by notions of Victorian womanhood and respectability, which you can see in some of the photographs. She was a very sort of conscious presentation that she had for herself in order to establish a base of authenticity to speak on a lot of the issues that she spoke about. Okay. Stop there for now. I'll get into the actual presentation, and we can return to some of these ideas in the question and answer period. Purpose of the project. This dissertation is an intellectual biography of the educator and activist Anna Julie Cooper, one that focuses on her most productive period between 1892 and 1925. In a way, it's patterned after recent work on influential African-American women, including recent biographies of Ida Wells Barnett, Lula Taylor's examination of Amy Jacques Garvey, and Gerald Horn's analysis of Shirley Graham Du Bois. Each of these texts, although concerned with recreating the life history of their central subjects, does so with an attentive ear towards the social, intellectual, and political worlds that these subjects inhabited and helped to create. This project examines Anna Julie Cooper's writing and political ideology, exploring both critical moments in her life as well as her self-proclaimed perspective as a black woman from the South. The attempt to analyze the personal and public life of Anna Julie Cooper requires a critical engagement with some of the major social and intellectual movements of her time, which include, perhaps most prominently, discourses of feminism, black nationalism, and progressivism. I argue that these discourses significantly influenced Anna Julie Cooper and other black women intellectuals and activists at the turn of the 20th century. Importantly, women have been recognized as central to the historical development of both feminism and progressivism. However, they have traditionally had a more ambivalent relationship with nationalism. Recent scholarship on the intersections of gender and nationalism documents a history of male dominance, effectively describing the ways that nationalist discourse have traditionally been both highly gendered and constructed in masculine terms. Yet major aspects of such critical work remains under investigation. On one hand, little is known about the ways that discourses of nationalism have been gendered female or constructed in feminine terms by African-American intellectuals. On the other hand, studies that emphasize black women's particular contributions to the nationalist tradition remain few and far between. These ideas are related but not the same. Considering the ways that nationalism has been gendered female highlights the pivotal role of gender in black intellectual thought at the turn of the 20th century, providing a more thorough examination of black intellectuals at a time when nationalist discourses were so influential. Despite the tendency towards sexism and misogyny in much of nationalist discourse, women have historically found progressive possibilities for nationalist movements, ideology, and rhetoric, possibilities that Anna Julie Cooper illustrates. Black female intellectuals and activists such as Cooper situated themselves in overlapping discourses of sex, race, class, and nation, while simultaneously confronting white American racism and black patriarchal oppression during the late 19th and early 20th centuries. The project considers the construction of ideology as a historical process, critically reading Anna Julia Cooper and select members of her intellectual community in relation to prominent trends in black intellectual thought. What type of nation did black women such as Cooper imagine? And how do they position themselves in such ideological formulations? This project argues that black women intellectuals were influenced by powerful movements like nationalism and feminism, and that such influences are identifiable in their intellectual productions. Although hindered by their gender in significant ways, black intellectual women were similar to black male intellectuals in that they constructed modern notions of race, gender, and nation as a part of their attempt to challenge white supremacy. The project centers on the life and work of Anna Julie Cooper and examines turn-of-the-century American society through her eyes. However, this reading also considers the significant factor of intellectual exchange among African Americans, I think that too often in African-American history, especially African-American intellectual history, when we think about African-American intellectuals, we think about them as sort of gendered and not working with one another. We think about male intellectuals like Du Bois as, you know, working maybe with other men. Sometimes we think about female intellectuals working with other women, but we don't tend to think about the sort of cross-fertilization that occurred. And that was a sort of major influence on Cooper, not only other women intellectuals, but male intellectuals as well. Cooper operated in and around a black intellectual elite community in Washington, D.C., one that included men and women such as Mary Church Terrell, Nannie Ellen Burroughs, Kelly Miller, Charlotte, and Francis Grimke, Carter Woodson, and Adeline Locke, just to name a few. In addition, Cooper influenced and was influenced by prominent individuals such as Josephine St. Pierre Ruffin, Ida Wells Barnett, Pauline Hopkins, and W.E.B. Du Bois. Figures residing outside the District of Columbia, such overlapping ideological influences and intellectual communities shaped Cooper's life experiences in significant ways. Although an established resident of the nation's capital and an affiliate of its black elite, Cooper was never completely accepted in black upper class social circles. However, her background, perspectives, marital and class status, occupational and religious affiliations, and educational and social connections uniquely positioned her to observe and participate in black Washington's intellectual life. Critical examination of Anna Julia Cooper will illuminate the contours of black intellectual discourse and community in urban centers. Therefore, my dissertation project begins with the following key questions. First, what was the significance of gender in Anna J. Cooper's life and work, and what was the nature of her relationship with the South? Second, how does Cooper's introduction of the theme of dependency, of legal language, and the metaphor of voice in her most celebrated writing, A Voice from the South, challenge our understanding of black women intellectuals? And finally, in what ways does Anna J. Cooper's critical engagement with discourses of race, region, and nation inform our understanding of black intellectual communities? Answering such questions will help illuminate the broader intellectual and social context that African-American men and women operated in between the 1890s and the 1920s. At this point, I want to start off with the first two quotes on the sheet we have. Oh. Goodness. The first quote comes from A Voice in the South. Let's take a look at that. The second one is actually a quote from her dissertation project, which was completed 3 decades later, 1925. And I start off with these two because this is primarily how I'm choosing to frame my project on Cooper. Again, her life was 105 years. And so I'm really looking at the most sort of active intellectual period for her, which was between 1892 and 1925. It's sort of framed by these two projects in a way. And also, I see the projects as related, although others haven't really seen a relationship between the two. I see them as very closely related. Okay, so the first quote, the other side has not been represented by the one who, quote, lives there, and not many can more sensibly realize and more accurately tell the weight and the fret of the long, dull pain than the open-eyed but hitherto voiceless black woman of America. At any rate, as our Caucasian barristers are not to blame if they cannot quite put themselves in the dark man's place, neither should the dark man be wholly expected, fully and adequately, to reproduce the exact voice of the black woman. And the second quote is, the revolution would finally bring about what even the principles of Christianity were unable to achieve. And all this arose at a time when the country was on the threshold of bankruptcy, when the people of France did not even have bread, and when the idleness of workers whose fate depended on the colonial trade was to be feared as much for social evil as for economic loss. Anna Julia Cooper's A Voice from the South by a black woman of the South is considered her most important work by contemporary commentators. The first excerpt comes early in Cooper's classic text, offering a glimpse of her political ideology, and this statement represents her general views as expressed in this collection of essays. A Voice from the South is a useful place to begin consideration of the intellectual arguments that Anna Julia Cooper would develop. In the first quotation, she indicts both white society and black men for their lack of appreciation of black women's perspectives. And the legal language of indictment recurs in subsequent essays, this being one of her favorite rhetorical strategies. Just prior to this excerpt, Cooper juxtaposed the, quote, American racial conflict with a legal context, one in which she felt compelled to testify, breaking the sort of silence that she believed had begun to characterize the entire southern region. This metaphor of silence, which I see as symbolic of a power relationship between men and women, can also be applied to the southern population in relation to the north and to the black population in relation to whites at the turn of this 20th century. She's very interested in power dynamics and relationships, ideas of independence and interdependence. Yet most often she would discuss the silence of black women. Anna Julie Cooper presumed to challenge this supposed silence with the metaphor of voice. You see this idea of voice recurring throughout the text, you know, the title obviously is a reference to that. And in so doing, she articulated a position of independence and authority both for herself and for the, quote, black woman generally. Anna J. Cooper used her specific subject position and particular sensibility as a black female freed slave at the turn of the century to enter political conversations regarding blacks and world history. And I'm going to get into her particular early life and background in a moment, but I think it's important to consider these things in relation to the fact that Cooper was a former slave, a freed slave, even though she went on to achieve all these things. And so her subject position in many ways, I think, was influenced by that throughout her life. Her dissertation project, entitled The Attitude of France Towards Slavery During the Revolution, 1788 to 1805, which she completed in 1925, more than three decades after Voice from the South, further solidified a position of independent authority for her. The second quotation in the epigraph drawn from her dissertation shows how Cooper sought to complicate notions of dependence. Here, Anna J. Cooper, the historian, posits national dependence and independence as complex power relationships, relationships with an identifiable history. In recasting the revolutionary movements in France and Haiti, and particularly the inability of French religious and social reformers to end the slave trade in Haiti, its most profitable colony, she emphasized the variables of race, class, and color, as well as transnational economic and political links. In many ways, then, Cooper's dissertation contained a key political component, and this historical work should be considered alongside her more well-known earlier writing. Cooper negotiated the themes of silence and voice at a crucial moment in African American history. A little more than 15 years after the close of Reconstruction, the year 1892 marked a high point for recorded lynchings of black Americans. In 1893, African Americans seeking recognition at the Columbian Exposition in Chicago, Cooper present among them, would be publicly slighted. They were both segregated from the white city, quote unquote, and represented in overtly racist ways. Furthermore, on the economic front, the nation had experienced a number of recessions since the end of the Civil War, and the 1890s were characterized by the worst economic downturns in the nation's history to that point. Booker T. Washington and his Tuskegee machine reached the pinnacle of its power by the middle of the decade, preaching the gospel of racial accommodation and industrial education for black people, and silencing those African-American voices critical of such a program. Segregation, already firmly entrenched on local and state levels, would be recognized nationally by the Supreme Court in Plessy versus Ferguson of 1896. At the same time, America was moving rapidly towards a more imperialistic foreign policy that would result in the subjugation of foreign territories, lands populated primarily by people of color. It was against such a tumultuous background that A Voice from the South appeared. In the opening epigraph, and we return to that first quote, Cooper first remarks that, to this point in history, the black woman's quote-unquote voice has been rendered inaudible, although in her opinion, the same black woman had repeatedly proven the most perceptive observer of the race problem. Immediately, one must question the target of her critique. By the quote, one who lives there, was she specifically referring to the white South, asserting that white Americans had failed to defend the interests of their darker Southern neighbors? Or rather, was she alluding to black male leaders' refusal to incorporate black women into their racial programs, thereby assigning black men partial responsibility for women's, quote, long, dull pain? Cooper would argue both positions over the course of her life, yet here in this last decade of the 19th century, she seems to emphasize the second option, directly addressing black men and charging them with neglect of black women's unique political perspectives. She parallels the way that Caucasians, not specifying male or female, have ignored the voices of black men with the way that black men, in turn, have failed to appreciate the voices of the black woman. Implicit is the idea that it may actually be impossible for black men to hear and fully appreciate this voice. Further justification for the view that, quote, the hitherto voiceless black woman of America, end quote, must be recognized as central to black political activism and ideology and included in progressive plans for liberation. This mingling of recognizably nationalist and feminist sentiments is characteristic of pronouncements of A Voice from the South. 3 years prior to Washington's famous speech at the Atlanta Cotton States Exposition, and in the same year that Ida Wells began her anti-lynching crusade, Cooper, in A Voice from the South, claimed a niche for the black woman as the savior not only of the United States, but of all Western civilization, taking up a vocation that the black man seemed incapable of fulfilling alone at the end of the 19th century. This is only one of the ways that she would recast notions of dependence and self-help in her political writing, in this case, juxtaposing black men's need for black women's quote-unquote voice with Western white culture's need for black perspectives, and introducing a theme that she would return to in her dissertation. picking up on a fairly common thesis of the time, she felt that the status of the, quote, black nation within a nation could be measured by the accomplishments, education, and respectability afforded to its women. This is but one of the ways that she found to link her gender and racial views. And such a synthesis has caused later scholars to regard Cooper's A Voice from the South as one of the earliest articulations of black feminist theory. Cooper's Voice from the South is noteworthy both for its form and its content. It's a text divided into two parts, the first one specifically addressing quote-unquote women's issues, and the second dealing more overtly with race matters. Although she positioned herself and in many ways based her authority on her location as a quote-unquote black woman from the South, the specific and the general, the local and the national function together in Cooper's view of world politics. Anna Cooper was in many ways a product of her time, yet she would repeatedly attempt to escape its geographical and ideological confines. Radical moves for a black former slave woman at the turn of the century. However, in a number of ways, and similarly to countless black nationalists with whom Cooper was quite familiar, her ideas have been characterized as essentially conservative by most scholars, forcing a reevaluation of the terms radical and conservative in their application to African American and women's political culture. Black nationalism is one concept used to describe the cultural identity and political consciousness of people of African descent in the United States and around the world, especially in the last two centuries. It is a way of looking at the world that has empowered individuals by allowing them to connect themselves to larger notions of community. However, many forms of nationalism have traditionally excluded, circumscribed, or proven hostile towards women, while such discourses remain highly gendered generally. Recently, scholars have begun to probe the specific gender content of nationalist forms in innovative ways. Addressing South Africa and responding to Benedict Anderson's famous formulation of the nation as an imagined community, Anne McGlintock finds that, quote, all nations are gendered, all are invented, and all are dangerous. McGlintock highlights the constructive nature of nationalist discourses while reminding us of the role that women and gender play within such discourses. Juggling the interrelated themes of race, class, gender, and sexuality in female political protest, black women activists have helped to create a radical tradition that cannot be adequately analyzed and viewed only through conventional lenses. Political scientist Cedric Robinson has outlined the contours of a black radical tradition of culture and intellectual thought, one that directly challenges traditional Marxist readings of history and struggle in relation to peoples of African descent. I'm interested in examining the contours of a black female radical tradition that may parallel this black radical tradition as generally conceived. What can Anna Julia Cooper's life and writings between 1892 and 1925 tell us about the dynamic nature of the society in these years? This crucial period in her life, one that biographer Leona Gable describes as a journey, quote, from slavery to the Sorbonne, begins with Cooper's earliest published writing and public pronouncements, collectively comprising A Voice from the South, and ends with the defense of her doctoral dissertation in Paris. It examines the ideology of Anna Julia Cooper in order to begin to probe the gender dimensions of black nationalist discourses at the turn of the century. Now I'm going to give you some information about her early life, and we can talk about how it relates to her work. Anna Julia Cooper, originally Anna Haywood, was born in 1858 to a slave woman named Hannah Stanley and George Haywood, Hannah Stanley's master, in Raleigh, North Carolina. Hence, her legal and social status for the first few years of her life was that of a slave. Cooper remarked of her own genealogy, quote, "The part of my ancestors that did not come over on the Mayflower in 1620 arrived, I am sure, a year earlier in the fateful Dutch trader that put in at Jamestown in 1619. I believe that the third source of my individual stream comes from the vanishing red men, which ought to make me a genuine first family of America." Cooper had tremendous love and respect for a mother who, in her words, sacrificed and toiled to give Anna the advantages she had never enjoyed herself. Cooper remembered that her mother, Hannah Stanley, had rarely mentioned her father/master. Moreover, Anna herself wrote of George Haywood that she owed him nothing beyond, quote, the act of procreation, clearly indicating her own feelings and possibly providing indirect evidence about the nature of her mother and father's, her biological father's relationship. Anna, her mother, and her two older brothers were most likely freed in 1863 as a result of the Emancipation Proclamation. Anna Cooper remembered knowing by kindergarten that she wanted to be an educator, and this appreciation for education would follow her for the rest of her life. Over the course of her 105-year life, she attended St. Augustine's Normal School in Raleigh, earned bachelor's and master's degrees from Oberlin College in Ohio in 1884 and 1887, respectively, and successfully defended her dissertation at the Sorbonne in Paris in 1925. Earning the PhD at the age of 66. Cooper taught and served as principal at the famous M Street colored M Street High School in Washington, D.C. for decades, retiring to become the second president of Frelinghuysen University, a group of schools for adult education in 1930. Anna Haywood had already entered St. Augustine's Normal School by 1867, and perhaps as early as 1865, during the height of Reconstruction, and she was soon advanced enough to tutor much older students. Demonstrating a feminist outlook as early as the 1870s, she protested the exclusion of women from male-only classes at St. Augustine's. This protest caused her to cross paths with the man she would marry in 1877, George A.C. Cooper, a theology student and Greek teacher at St. Augustine's. However, George Cooper died suddenly in 1879, ending the happy union after only 2 years. I think it's significant that Cooper would spend the last 80 years of her life as a widow. This really would influence her sort of interaction with the intellectual elite in D.C. and other areas. Anna Julia Cooper would never remarry, but much later she would take on the responsibilities of motherhood. In 1881, she left St. Augustine's and traveled to Ohio, where she enrolled at Oberlin College, one of the few traditional schools open to African Americans. Along with classmates Mary Church Terrell and Ida A. Gibbs Hunt, she matriculated through the gentleman's course and graduated from Oberlin in 1884, following Mary Jane Patterson as the first black woman to complete a four-year course of study from accredited American college. Mary Jane Patterson, turns out, was also from Raleigh, so I'm thinking that there might be some connections between the two of them, at least as a sort of inspirational source for her. Mary Jane Patterson would also go on to move to Washington, D.C. and become the first president of the M Street School, where Cooper would later become president, our principal, excuse me. One of the best biographical works on Anna Julia Cooper is Louise Daniel Hutchinson's work that was produced as a part of a Smithsonian exhibit on Anna Julia Cooper in 1981, which treats Cooper's Oberlin experience as particularly significant, orienting her with a community of black Americans a generation removed from slavery. This period in her life is described as crucial for her subsequent political development, as her own feelings of connection with the black community and her desire to quote-unquote uplift them was reinforced by the students and teachers at Oberlin. Cooper had a particular interest in the young black woman as a segment of the population routinely neglected. For her, the turn of the century truly was woman's era. The concern with black women would remain crucial to her politics for the remainder of her life. For Cooper, black women's experiences and perspectives served as a window or point of entry into a number of larger issues. In Hutchinson's words, quote, Cooper left Oberlin eager to serve those who were unserved. Confident, poised, self-assured, and armed with an AB, she felt ready to address the inequities and indignities that black women like her mother had experienced in slavery in the post-Civil War South. Cooper postponed her plans to return to North Carolina, teaching for a year at Wilberforce College in Ohio in 1884. As a devout Episcopalian, she, quote unquote, established and maintained contacts in the national black church community while at Wilberforce. Important examples included the Bishop Benjamin Arnett, a noted leader in the AME Church, whom she admired for his support of black women's causes. Arnett would later write an introduction to A Voice from the South. Cooper also established and maintained connections with such well-known black figures as Alexander Crummell, Francis Grimke, Walter H. Brooks, and Alexander Walters. Anna Cooper eventually did return to North Carolina in 1885, where she taught mathematics, Greek, and Latin at St. Augustine's for 2 years before being recruited to Washington, D.C. in 1887 to join the faculty of the colored M Street School, later renamed Paul Orange Dunbar High. Making use of prior connections, Cooper resided with the Reverend Alexander Crummell and his wife, joining a list of boarders already living there, which included her former classmate, Mary Church Terrell. One can only imagine the intense intellectual exchange that must have occurred in the Crummell home with some of the finest black minds of the period under one roof. This group of intellectuals recognized the significance of their position in the nation's capital and the links between local and national black communities. Social activism was encouraged and taken very seriously in Washington, D.C. This sort of Anna Julia Cooper, Mary Church Terrell relationship is significant on a number of levels, but it seems to have been one that was problematic. They didn't like each other. There was something about it. Not necessarily sure what it was, but for some reason they didn't like each other. And it's interesting because their lives were paralleled in so many ways. They went to Oberlin together. They moved to D.C. and taught together. They were both involved in a club, women's movement, so on and so forth. But this is part of Anna Julia Cooper's sort of insider-outsider position in D.C. intellectual community. We'll talk about this more later. Anna Julia Cooper would remain active in Washington, D.C. for the remainder of her life. However, in her 50s, she took on the role of guardian to five of her great nieces and nephews. As a faculty member and later principal of the prestigious M Street High School, she was known for maintaining high academic standards. Notably, Cooper's curriculum was a combination of traditional and industrial training. Under her tenure, the school developed a reputation for excellence, and she was well known for garnering agreements which enabled qualified M Street graduates to attend top schools such as Harvard and Yale. Think about this, in the 1880s and 1890s, she's sending these students to Harvard and Yale, really unheard of in a lot of ways. Her curricular program was one that emphasized self-help and individual morality as a means to challenge white supremacy. Cooper's biographers posit that such activities angered some of her superiors on the Washington, D.C. school board, and she would suffer setbacks as a result of this. This it really brings us to this M Street controversy that I referred to early on. I'll describe what that entailed at this point. In 1901, Anna Julie Cooper succeeded Robert Terrell, husband of Mary Church Terrell, who was also a school board member. Yet she constantly battled with her superiors over the nature of the school's curriculum and was drawn into the political fray despite her attempt to remain outside of it. For example, Cooper invited W.B. Du Bois to speak at M Street during the 1902-1903 school year, shortly after becoming principal. Even though she tried to occupy middle ground in the debate between them, which was becoming increasingly polarized, Du Bois used the platform provided to make remarks critical of Tuskegee, possibly angry Booker T. Washington. In any case, in 1906, Cooper was removed from her position shortly after Washington's own visit to M Street in 1905. Although formally charged with insubordination stemming from a refusal to abandon the classical part of the M Street curriculum, allegations of sexual impropriety with John Love, one of Cooper's foster children, proved far more damaging. These charges were made public and were carried by the local press as the M Street controversy, and led directly to Cooper's contract not being renewed. Think about this in relation to the respectability ideas that I was trying to refer to earlier. You can see from the photographs that she considered respectability to be an important thing, something that she would respect her for the rest of her life. In 1906, she would move to Jefferson City, Missouri, teaching at Lincoln University until 1911. This tactic of disciplining women seen as overstepping their bounds and challenging men is one that requires further discussion. Anna Julie Cooper defies simplistic categorization. As biographer Louise Hutchinson remarks, best known as an educator, Cooper is also a feminist, human rights advocate, distinguished scholar, essayist, lecturer, and vital force to the late 19th century Black Women's Club movement. She could have easily added Black nationalist and Pan-Africanist intellectual to this impressive list. Cooper attended the World's Congress in Chicago. She was, by some accounts, the only woman elected to membership in the prestigious American Negro Academy. There's sort of conflicting reports on whether or not she was actually a member of the American Negro Academy. And delivered a paper at the first Pan-African Conference in London in 1900. However, she is best known for a powerful collection of essays, A Voice from the South by a Black Woman of the South. A Voice from the South by a Black Woman of the South, organized in two parts, is a complicated enunciation of late 19th century political ideology. This collection of prior speeches, assembled alongside essays, probably written specifically for this volume between 1886 and 1892, demonstrates Cooper's juxtaposition of feminism and nationalism in the Black and American struggles. She did not see a paradox in this conflation. In fact, it was central to her intellectual outlook. Notably, while the first part of the book challenges more conventional feminists and emphasizes themes that have come to be associated with contemporary Black feminism, the second part is more traditionally race-conscious in its concerns. Yet both sections persuasively demonstrate her views on what she considered the most pressing national issues and concerns. And other writing on Cooper, they tend to focus on A Voice from the South and don't really talk about anything else, but they also tend to focus just on the first part of the book, the one that deals, quote unquote, with women's issues. But I think there are interesting things in the second part as well. The initial part of Cooper's work entertains the notion of Black women's role in the regeneration of civilization, particularly in America. Cooper addresses multiple audiences in this first part. The essay entitled, quote, Womanhood, a Vital Element in the Regeneration and Progress of the Race, end quote, was the written version of a speech delivered before a group of Black male AME church leaders. In this oral text related in a written form, Cooper can be heard rebuking these pious Black men for their mistreatment of Black women and challenging them to appreciate Black women's special talents and needs. In the process, she verbally connected herself to a tradition of Black leadership that included Crummell and Henry McNeil Turner. Next in the essay, quote, The Higher Education of Women, end quote, Cooper notes the tremendous educational progress of Black women over the course of the 19th century. In protesting against the attempt to prohibit the education of women, she traces a genealogy of historic women while posing the notion of Eastern superiority to the Western world. Then in quote, Woman versus the Indian, end quote, Cooper directly challenged white feminist leaders such as the Reverend Anna Shaw. She got that title from one of the feminist leader Anna Shaw's speeches, claiming a sort of moral high ground for black women. Lastly, in quote, The Status of Women in America, she continued this feminist critique, all while offering a revision of American historical development, one emphasizing women's centrality. The first part of A Voice from the South has received by far the most treatment, but Cooper does significant things in part two of her text, particularly in the chapter entitled, quote, Has America a Race Problem? Question mark. Her analysis of the development of civilization reverses conventional narratives as she concludes that all the major empires have ceased to be quote-unquote dominant, not because of a quote-unquote race problem, but specifically because these societies lacked a race problem. This lack of strife in the context of race relations meant that these societies degenerated into caste systems, which were resistant to change, leading to societal stagnation, the death warrant of any culture, in her opinion. Her teleological account moves through the Greek and Roman empires, as well as through Asian and European civilizations on the way to discussing the American case. In order to support the assertion that America's biggest race problem, then considered its greatest dilemma, may eventually prove its greatest asset. Here in her earliest published work, one sees Cooper rhetorically manipulating notions of white supremacy and racism, simultaneously arguing against prejudice and white supremacy, all while turning consideration of a race, quote unquote, race problem on its head, and arguing for the American nation's dependence on African Americans. Cooper's pronouncements may be read in terms of American exceptionalism with important revisions. The American nation had a certain world destiny, in Cooper's opinion, one for which God and history had been preparing it. Quote, the fact is this nation was foreordained to conflict from its incipiency. America is not from choice more than necessity, republic in form and democratic in administration. If white racial supremacy was a truism at that moment, Cooper's optimistic view held that it could not ultimately sustain itself. According to her exceptionalist standpoint, not only did America serve as a beacon of civilization for the rest of the world, but black people constituted its central pillar. African Americans had a key role to play in this nation's future, although Cooper observed that their role had been overlooked in the past and diminished at that present moment. Cooper's viewpoint is international in scope, and her argument is transnational in orientation, yet it is inherently nation-based. Importantly, this second part of Abortion in the South, which deals with quote-unquote race issues, developed many of the points introduced in part one's discussion of quote-unquote women's issues. Again, I think the sort of synthesis of the two parts is interesting to consider. Anna Dillard Cooper's A Voice from the South facilitates an exploration of the intersections of Southern history, African-American history, and women's history at a critical historical moment. This paper considers Cooper within these cultural and historical contexts. In addition, it's concerned with both the contours of her life and with what her life and work can tell us about nationalist and black intellectual discourses in American society between 1890 and the second decade of the 20th century. Cooper moved frequently in black nationalist circles. She drew upon black nationalist ideas in public speaking and writing, and her overarching concern was with the black population in the U.S. at the turn of the century. Moreover, she drew upon diverse strains of thought such as feminism, pan-Africanism, and Christian theology, yet all were directed towards the project of black liberation, and her early work was explicitly gendered female. At this point, two important questions remain. First, how might Cooper's position in turn of the century political discourses of race, region, and nation help expand traditional definitions of black nationalism? And second, the participation in such discourses and her explicit introduction of gender and womanhood as central themes alter the nature of this activism in any way. Cooper's affiliation and relationship with the South was significant on many levels and merits further discussion. When abortion in the South appeared in the 1890s, the overwhelming majority of black Americans continued to reside in the southern states, yet black southerners and the region generally were still recovering from the destruction of the Civil War and the discord of the Reconstruction era. Thus, Cooper centered her discussion of global politics and regional relations on the South, and therefore placing the region into a position of prominence was doubly meaningful. Between the 1890s and 1920s, her focus broadened, but the South and relations between the races remained central. At the turn of the century, the District of Columbia constituted much more than just a physical border between the North and the South. It also supported a large and significant portion of the African-American elite of the time. A generation before the Harlem Renaissance, when New York developed into the, quote, capital of black America, Washington, D.C. became a center of black political and cultural life, as well as a destination for black migrants from the South. Communities of color flourished in the nation's capital, and Cooper had aligned herself with this critical mass by the late 1880s. Her educational efforts at M Street, the Colored High School, and her affiliation with individuals like the Reverend Crummell and Francis of Charlotte Wimke, and with religious and civic organizations like the AME Church, Black Women's Clubs, and the Colored Social Sediment Movement, ensure her knowledge of and participation in a variety of enterprises associated with race work. Clearly, Black activism in the nation's capital resonated far beyond the district's borders. Anna J. Cooper's interest in the broader issues facing Blacks and women predates her move to the district and may in fact have fueled the desire to make such a move. Cooper lived most of her adult life in Washington, D.C., but she continued to base her ability to speak for the race on her Southern roots and on her experiences as a Black woman. Useful to consider in relation to the notions of region and nation are the intellectual conversations regarding the fate of Black America between Cooper and Northern and Southern Blacks, such as Crummell, Ida Wells Barnett, Mary Church Terrell, Charlotte and Francis Grimke, W.B. Du Bois, and others during her long stay in the nation's capital. What does it mean that Cooper emphasized the resilience of Southern culture in the same year that Ida Wells was attacking the savagery of American culture as part of her radical anti-lynching discourse? Why is it significant that Cooper discussed the vital contributions of Black women to Western culture a decade before Du Bois published The Souls of Black Folk, hailing Black cultural contributions to Western civilization? Cooper's relationship with the South was a literal and a metaphorical one. She viewed the South both as her primary field of activism and as an inlet into national and international politics. And although her interests were Pan-Africanist and, as I argue, nationalist, her immediate field of activism was necessarily local and it faced southward. Let's spend just a minute talking about her dissertation and relating it to what we already discussed. Cooper's historical research on France and its colonial possessions, completed in 1925, links the notion of nationalism with international concerns, particularly historical relations between France and Haiti. Her doctoral dissertation, entitled The Attitude of France Towards Slavery During the Revolution, defended in Paris, is a striking example of how she theorized this linkage. Her research and writing may be effectively read in light of notions of Pan-Africanism and African diaspora, particularly regarding their emphasis on transnational linkages in economics and politics. For Cooper and others, this intellectual work often took place through the guise and through identifiably Western and normative discourses of civilization and progress. For example, by recasting notions of independence in the case of the Haitian and French Revolution, Cooper challenged the notion of autonomy in the modern world and ultimately the notion of national sovereignty. In Cooper's formulation, power relations after the outbreak of the French Revolution contradict traditional conceptions of the colonial relationship between France and Haiti. In her historical narrative, not only was the French Revolution intimately tied to the Haitian Revolution, but the French Revolution fell short of its goals, specifically because of the rebellion of the slaves in Haiti. She concluded that France's inability to extend the notions of liberty, equality, and fraternity to the slaves of Haiti undercut the power of the French Revolution at home. In this instance, discourses of Western rationalism and civilization were transformed from an ideological asset to a political liability, much to the chagrin of the French. Cooper's historical revision represents a reversal of power roles from margin to center, one that developed from her particular standpoint as a former slave and as a 19th century Black Southern woman. When comparing her dissertation on the French and Haitian revolutions with a voice from the South, one sees that Cooper viewed male dominance, racial dominance, and colonial dominance as a series of parallel power relationships. It's my assertion that her position as a Black woman and a Southerner informs this perspective. Cooper earned her PhD from the Sorbonne in 1925, yet her own personal success would not separate her from attempting to understand the vulnerability of African-American women, especially young women. Her political program was feminist in that she took a particular interest in addressing the unique forms of oppression faced by young Black women, yet she used this specific concern to launch an attack against racial discrimination directed at all people of color over her lifetime. She used gender to theorize racial identity, racism, imperialism, and womanhood, and the imperialism and womanhood to discuss nationhood, drawing unconventional conclusions about the relationship between national dependence and independence. Cooper recognized relationships of dependency on local, regional, national, and international levels, and her frame of reference shifted among these contexts as needed. As stated, she had a particular preoccupation with the young womanhood of the race, and she felt that the status of the Black nation was most often measured by its women. This juxtaposition of Black nationhood with the position of Black women and womanhood was crucial to her outlook. Cooper drew upon her own experience of enslavement to read prior histories of slavery and emancipation, as well as to analyze the American racial context from a global perspective. Therefore, consideration of the dynamics of slavery should not be divorced from the examination of her life and career. Her significance as a historian of slavery, racism, and imperialism contains added significance because of her former slave status. Cooper's ability to speak for the race, to articulate a voice, was directly related to her origins in the slave South. Yet she would make a conscious decision in choosing to articulate broader notions of enlightenment, culture, and justice. She considered slavery and freedom universal concepts in human history, yet she also read these in relation to her own experience and in relation to the experiences of former slaves in the U.S. Hers was a region and nation-based global vision. Okay, let's skip, because I'm getting near the conclusion now. A lot of the best work on Angela Cooper is comes from black feminist theorists and black women's historians. And I've learned a lot from them, but there's also some things that I think they could develop a bit further, so I want to try to do that in this project. Black feminism as a theoretical tradition has sought societal transformation in addition to group survival by building on the lived experiences of black women, hence appreciating rather than invalidating their particular perspectives. Nationalism, too, is an intellectual tradition that arises initially out of individual experience, seeking greater levels of autonomy and power for individuals and groups. In theory, the goals of black nationalism and black feminism would seem identical. However, black women have traditionally been forced to choose agitation on behalf of their race over activism on behalf of their sex, and this pressure for them to be quote-unquote race women was particularly strong in the later part of the 19th century. It's my argument that Anna Julie Cooper and others attempted to resist such pressures. She picked her battles carefully, most often attacking local or regional challenges, but always struggling with broader implications in mind. Moreover, I argue that as a woman who encountered a number of burdens as a result of her sex, her activities were of particular significance to the entire black community, male and female. Cooper's protest, then, has added meaning in this context because America is not just a racist society, it's also a sexist one. Much of black women's oppression has resulted from particular racial and sexual stereotypes. African Americans and women have historically been excluded from democratic political participation in this country, at least in its traditional forms, and therefore have learned to function outside of conventional political channels. Therefore, it's necessary to justify the use of certain terms because unequivocal application of terms such as nationalism and political can be problematic. Benedict Anderson's notion of the imagined community is particularly poignant in this context because it shifts the emphasis away from strict structural analysis of nationalism. Additionally, historian Robin Kelly has problematized the political in this way, quote, "Too often political is defined by how people participate rather than why. By traditional definition, the question of what is political hinges on whether or not groups are involved in elections, political parties, or grassroots social movements," end quote. From this statement, one may infer that racial and gender particularities affect conceptions of what is political behavior. For example, discussing how and why black women participated in the political process before 1920, when they were granted the legal right to vote, requires analysis of the restrictive mechanisms used to keep women from voting and illegal and customary practices of disenfranchising African Americans. Considering Kelly's how and why in respect to black women allows for a richer discussion of minority group politics. This paper can be summarized in three general contentions. First, forms of nationalism are deeply gendered. Second, nationalism functions as an analytical category useful for examining American history in general and African American history in particular. Lastly, Anna Julie Cooper serves as a prime example of turn-of-the-century black woman intellectualism. Her conception of nationalism was at once similar to and divergent from traditional forms. Moreover, I argue that studying Cooper in this way will not only tell us more about her, but will also provide a new insight into the historical construction of African-American leadership and the black intellectual in the 19th and 20th century. Individuals such as Cooper were forced to negotiate gender, place, and notions of dependency in addition to the ever-present factor of race. I'm going to go ahead and stop there, I'm out of time.
I guess I'll start off. I was really intrigued by your the timeline and your discussion of sort of the W.E.B. Du Bois, Booker T. Washington debate, and sort of Andrea Cooper kind of finding herself in the middle of it, so to speak. I mean, she invites one to the high school, and then she invites the other one, and shortly thereafter, she's dismissed. How much is known about, I guess, how she sort of positioned herself in that debate? Was she one trying to synthesize the two positions? Was she closer to one rather than the other? And how did she understand her, I guess, invitations of these two who were obviously duking out in public? In fact, you know, it was known that at that time, I think that Washington, if people didn't go along with this program, and you know, he had, you know, connections to pull strings to get people fired, to get people, you know, or to I guess diminish their opportunities and so on. So I mean, clearly she was playing with dynamite, I guess. If she, yeah, I mean, I guess what's known about that?
We do know some things about that. I mean, it's interesting that Cooper is sort of representative of a lot of black women educators, and that she tried to synthesize both of the sort of extreme positions. It's interesting that under her tenure at M Street, that the school actually split. There was a sort of dual training session going on, but it split under her tenure with the Armstrong Manual Institute, sort of split off from that, because people thought that there wasn't enough emphasis on industrial training. So she sort of had an investment in both types of education. Mm-hmm. Yes, she was still this sort of classically trained, and this was this sort of a major investment for her as well. I mean, she, you know, studied Greek and Latin, spoke mm-hmm. French, German, and other things. She taught Latin at the school. You see photos of entry, for example, you know, the students are very well dressed, the military sort of regalia and that type of stuff. So it was very much invested in the sort of liberal classical models as well. But she did try to navigate. She thought that people should have the opportunity to do both, especially African Americans, that it was important to have the opportunity to do both. But she's not able to sort of navigate that middle course, like you were saying. It's interesting, too. She's in D.C., which is a sort of major political center. She invites Du Bois to come speak in 1902, 1903. It's interesting, the year before that, Du Bois had actually applied to be the assistant superintendent of schools in D.C. and asked Booker T. Washington for a letter of recommendation. This was before their major blow-up. Booker T. initially agrees, and then later sort of reconsiders, like, no, there's a little bit too much going on down there in D.C. I don't have control over that area the way I'd want, and withdraws his letter of recommendation. This is really when, you know, shortly thereafter, Souls of Black Folk appears and the other thing. And so this is their split is, you know, complete by that point. But it's interesting because, I mean, this is a particular historical circumstance for this sort of debate to develop, and she becomes one of the casualties of that in a lot of ways, although other things were brought up to sort of justify that position. But she maintained, I mean, she had spoken on podiums with Booker T. Washington early on. Mm-hmm. She had this long-term correspondence with Du Bois, even though he acted kind of funny in certain instances. But, I mean, as late as the 1930s, and she was still writing it. You know, there's a letter between the two of them where she, after this particularly racist book on Reconstruction comes out, she writes Du Bois a letter and says, we need you to answer this, man, come on. It's 1929, she says, you know, we need a response to this. Yeah. Basically, you're the man, you know, we need you to do it. This is December of 1929. In 1935, Du Bois' Black Reconstruction comes out. The idea is that he may have been thinking about articles beforehand, but he stated he didn't want to write a book. But it's interesting that there's this sort of long-term correspondence with results that we can see. So it was definitely an interesting sort of situation, especially in D.C. at this time period, when D.C. is really the major sort of center before Harlem blows up into that world.
Yeah.
It's an important question. I want to find out a little more about that, because there's still some paper trails that I'm left in the world, but there definitely was a connection.
The American conceptualism on that extremely interesting, especially since you juxtapose her with Du Bois and some of this liberal thought that, you know, we'll get there someday. Do you see the same sort of, especially because they both lived, you know, long lives, you see the same sort of, okay, maybe what I was thinking 50 years ago wasn't the best thing. Does she sort of step away and maybe think that America isn't the exception, isn't the model?
That's a good question. I don't see her developing the same way that Du Bois did, as far as like his class radicalism and Marxism and that type of stuff. She didn't go that route. Like one of the last quote I think on there is her saying, "I'm not a Negro, never have been," kind of thing. She didn't really connect herself. She connected herself very much to the politics, but the presentation was something that was important to her, not to be involved with that type of thing. One of the scholars I read on her talks about. She dies in 1964, a year before Black Power as a strategy becomes a major idea. And this author said that how he says it, but he says basically that she would agree with the politics of Black Power, but she would have thought it was rude, you know. So it's that kind of navigation, especially as a single widowed Black woman, that I think she was constantly navigating. When I first thought about that idea of American exceptionalism, I talked about her relation to African American exceptionalism, because although she thought she was very invested in sort of Western civilization in a lot of ways. Even though she tried to undermine it in certain cases, but you still see her talking a lot about civilization, progress, which, I mean, makes sense in the 1890s especially. But it was very much tied to the U.S. as the sort of be-all, end-all in certain ways. But, I mean, in other cases, you can see her privileging somewhere like France. You know, when she goes to do her dissertation, she wants to go to France to do it. I think it's no, one thing that I get to in the conclusion is, I said, I don't think it was coincidence that she goes to Paris to do this. Even though she wanted to bring this knowledge back to D.C. to sort of, you know, remain an activist as far as African Americans are concerned. But, you know, she did hold France out as this sort of exception, in certain cases, better than the U.S. Even though she was critical of them as well, her dissertation is interesting to look at this whole Haitian-French Revolution, because she was a very religious person. She was very sort of invested in France and Western civilization. But she's very critical of France. I mean, I couldn't do it. I mean, even the sort of religious aspect of it. She's more religious aspect of it. She's most critical of the sort of religious reformers and her inability to affect change in the Haitian Revolution to extend these rights. So although she was invested, I think she saw nothing better, but she did think about it, at least, I would say. But I think that that term American exceptionalism is something I want to stick with and think about more, too. Even though she had, you know, black people at the center of that exceptionalism.
But the quote that you give is, you know, is not necessarily unique to her, because you see sort of the same theme in souls of black folks in a more critical way. But I find that really interesting.
So yeah, I think it was definitely something common to the time. I think maybe her difference between a major difference between her and the boys would be that she was the sort of level type thing. She's American exceptionalism on one level. Below that, African Americans as central to that American exceptionalism. And below that, African American women as central to African Americans as central to the American exceptionalism. That's maybe where her and the boys might have differed. Although at certain points of his career, that was an emphasis of his as well. But to her, it was central that the black woman was going to save Western civilization. This is her sort of radical departure in a lot of ways. This is the one that we can see everything. We have the perspective to do it because of the various oppressions and intersectionality that is talked about now. This was her major thing. And that's why she was so preoccupied with African American women, although she was involved in educational activities for the overall community. This is why this was so central to her. I think that's a major, there are some definite similarities, I think, with others in her intellectual community at the time. Any other questions? Dr. Miller?
Obviously, we can talk about this at length, but it's been some time since I've heard your project. So let me, in the essence effort of time, first of all, throw out this notion, not just as D.C. as this intellectual and political center of black life, but certainly the way that the colored, light-skinned elite functioned and how she negotiated that community, because this is something I just learned about. I didn't realize this was that big a deal. I learned this. Darnell, you probably bet. And it still functions today as really a secret society. So that's just something to consider. You don't have to necessarily answer it. And also your two definitions now, the first, nationalism versus nation state or nation building. And I say that because if you pick up Toni Morrison's quote that talks about canon building is nation building. And Cooper was definitely developing a canon as well as a nation. And the second, can you explain to me, this is a question, last one. What is your definition, or how do you understand American exceptionalism? To make sure I understand it.
I mean, a lot of it has to do with religious, for her especially, a lot of it had to do with the sort of religious, sort of teleological process that civilization was progressing towards this point and that America was really at the top of that point right now. The sort of, I mean, you can take it back to the Puritanism, you know, the city on the hill, all that kind of stuff. That America could be the sort of, I guess I'm starting with the last question first, but that America could start with, America was really could be the savior of civilization, especially Western civilization, but the whole world. This is where the potential was. She wasn't saying that it was there now, but this is where the potential was. And people have talked about that, and people have developed that idea and talked about how that's both radical and conservative at the same time. And to me, that's interesting, the way they can be radical and conservative at the same time. But this was really the sort of exceptionalism that I have in mind with her. In some cases, the term doesn't fit, which is why I was thinking about African-American exceptionalism, then I went to African-American women's exceptionalism, and then I'm like, okay, let's get too complicated, let's go back to American exceptionalism. These are the general thoughts that I had in mind regarding that. As far as the nationalism versus nation state, this has been a major issue, as you know, for me. Because when you're doing reading on nationalism, traditionally, all the traditional readings of nationalism deal with is the nation state. This nation interacting with that one, so on and so forth. Political governments, all of that's interesting. It's not really interesting to me, especially because of the fact that I'm more interested in black nationalism, African-American nationalism particularly, which doesn't always follow those same patterns. When we think about African American nationalism in the U.S., mm-hmm. Not necessarily advocating for a separate nation state, although many forms do. But a lot of times it has to do with working within the society you're in. A lot of times it has to do more with nationalist consciousness, thinking of yourself as a community. And this is where Benedict Anderson's work has been particularly useful in the early 90s, because he really sort of turned the tide in making people think about nationalist consciousness, this idea of the imagined community, how people imagine themselves as a part of the community, and how that sometimes relates to a nation state, but sometimes it doesn't. I think that's much more useful for thinking about African-American forms of nationalism and women in relation to nationalism, because women have this sort of different relationship to the nation state in a lot of ways. So, I mean, it still could be, you know, sort of fuzzy, I think, though, because it still could be problematic to be using some of the definitions for a nation state to talk about this. But this is the sort of distinction that I have in mind between the two. As far as the first question, this was one of the major shifts of the project, in that when I first started on Cooper, I was just interested in Cooper. And then I got into the whole D.C. black elite, what an elite means in a lot of ways. What does it mean to be an elite African-American woman, former slave, widow of a certain particular class? And there's a lot of recent writing on this, too, which has been really influential, really helped me think through it a lot. I think that, you know, studying Cooper is useful in a lot of ways, particularly because of the way she's situated. She was a lighter skin, and so on some levels, when you're reading about the D.C. intellectual elite, she should have had access to certain things. But she doesn't. I mean, in some cases she does, in some cases she doesn't. She's very much this sort of insider-outsider. Her situation paralleled very closely one of her contemporaries, Nanny Helen Burroughs, who was also an educator in D.C., but with much darker skin, was seen as lower class and not cultured, quote-unquote, all this kind of stuff. And it's interesting. I think a lot of it had to do with the fact that she was a former slave and that she emphasized the status, whereas most members of the intellectual elite tended to distance themselves from that, with a notable exception, someone like Frederick Douglass. But for the most part, you would, you know, count back how many generations your family had been free and that sort of thing. Also, not being attached to a husband was something that I think really affected her access to a lot of these things. I mean, she wasn't invited to the dinner party. You know, who's she going to bring? You know, it's simple on that level, but very significant in other levels. And I mean, I don't know, I think a lot of it had to do with her intellectual thoughts, too. I think that although she was very attached to ideas of Victorian womanhood in certain cases, even by being a sort of public figure, she sort of transgressed that in other cases, too. So it's interesting to think about this sort of radical and conservative again together. This is one of the things that one of the chapters I'm going to write on this has to do with this intellectual elite. And even, you know, discussing what this term means, because for African Americans and women in particular, this idea of elite is not necessarily the same thing as class. It's not necessarily just tied to economics, because she was poor for a lot of her life. She was, you know, sort of making it, but not really in certain cases. We see it for other African-American intellectuals at the time, too, even for people like Du Bois. He writes a letter to his wife is like, we're broke, you know. There are letters between them, and we tend to think of them as not being that. And of course, in relation to other African-Americans, they were, you know, well off. So we have to think about these, I think, in complicated ways, especially for single African-American women that were former slaves. But I think she does provide an opportunity to discuss those issues. Did I answer your questions? Thank you for the questions. Any others? I've kept you here longer than you may have wanted. George Turner. Anything else? Comments? Want to throw food or anything? Thank you very much.
Yeah, I know.
I'm sorry.
Okay.
Why two of them?
Yeah, you can go 0 or 2.
Okay.
Yeah, but you have an account.